your teaching learning evaluation system, everything will be merged together in future through different kind of interoperability standards. And see, you know, sign and symbols are already clear. And a little bit of that particular issue I'll be talking today, that is managed, and that particular thing is called managed learning environment. And I'll be talking on that thing today. So it towards a grand unification of informatics and e-learning. This particular grand unification, as a proof of concept related to managed learning environment. First, what do I mean by informatics? And everybody knows. So informatics is a little bit of a new term for many of you, except the person who are actually participated here without the library and information science background. So let me explain a bit that informatics from the point of view of library and information science, that it is basically related to the activities, all activities related to design, manage, evaluate information services. And you can say it's a librarianship class, because in this particular informatics, you need to learn what is information architecture, digital preservation, digital asset management, design and management of metadata-based information services, web-based interoperability, database design, semantic web technologies, geographical information system, text analysis, and many more. So you can see these are the all kind of facets I have given here, which considered as part of informatics. And e-learning, on the other hand, that every ICT enabling is called e-learning. And unfortunately, we use e-learning as an umbrella term, as a generic term to mean everything. For example, I am using a PowerPoint slide in my smart classroom. I may consider I am doing e-learning. But e-learning is everything is not e-learning. If you teaching, learning, evaluation, all three facets are not covered in an online interactive mode, that can be considered as an e-learning. And again, e-learning actually went through different kind of phases. I will be covering three distinct phases of e-learning. One is called digital learning environment. With the advent of internet, we are able to provide our structured courseware to the learners in an interactive mode, and that is called digital learning environment, which takes care of the which actually based on the network as the asset. Then in the next phase, that is in the beginning of 21st century, we entered into the era of virtual learning. What is virtual learning? Virtual learning environment is nothing but when digital learning environment is attached to it, a group of asynchronous and synchronous communication tools. Asynchronous communication tools means you are not connected in real time, like your email, like your blog post. And synchronous tool of communication means you are connected in real time, like this video conferencing, instant messaging, relay chats. So when all this asynchronous and synchronous mode of communication merged seamlessly with digital learning and support teacher-to-teacher, teacher-learner, learner-to-learner communication, then we have achieved virtual learning environment. Now the present era, that is the era started after 2012, that is called managed learning environment. Different sub-components like your library system, like your financial system, like your admission system, examination system, all subsystems, you are able to merge with virtual learning environment, then we call that it is a managed learning environment. So I will be taking care of the informatics, how informatics can be integrated inside your typical teaching learning evaluation. We call it virtual learning environment. So before making a quantum jump into all technical details and other demonstration kind of thing, let me tell you one thing, that what I am so much interested to see the merging of informatics and e-learning, because the paradigm shift has already happened. And what do I mean by paradigm shift? E-learning, do not consider that e-learning is a child of this pandemic situation. e-learning is yet to came here to stay with us for the coming future, for the coming many years actually. And because of its own strength, maybe the pandemic situation is actually creating or acting providing some kind of catalytic effect. It is actually speeding up the process, but it is not the only responsible factor which actually leading us towards the e-learning process. So what do I mean by the paradigm shift? It is not actually the pandemic situation I am trying to mean. What do I mean? That four fundamental factors of for the last 15 years are actually changing the way we interact with each other, the way we communicate with each other in the scholarly world, the way we go for different facets of teaching learning evaluation. So what are these four factors? These four factors are the platform, that is the open and distributed information system, which we people colloquially call as internet. It is acting as the platform for scholarly communication. Then comes the open source software, open standard. Now you see the entire internet is built on the top of open source software and open standards. You go for any, for example, possibly at this very moment you are accessing this web conferencing system either through your Google Chrome web browser and Mozilla Firefox. Both are open source. 95% of the web servers are running on the top of Apache web server. It's the software, server software, again at open source. 90% of the web servers are running on the top of open source operating system, different flavors of Linux, again open source software. And the entire communication process includes different heterogeneous devices like your smartphone, my laptop. Tito is actually having it from its laptop. We are using different operating system, different hardware, different makes. So how internet is providing our all of these heterogeneous devices because of a common standard we all follow, that is called TCP/IP. So like TCP/IP, many open standards we are following, the entire internet, entire process is built on the top of open standards. Now on the top of these two ingredient factors or the cementing factors, we have slowly started with two different system. One is called open access system and other is the open learning system. And throughout this deliberation now I will be showing you that how it is quite impossible to separate these two inseparable components of teaching learning evolution facet, that is open access publishing, open educational resources, as well as the open learning system we are going through. So these are quite inseparable from each other, and integration is already conceptually happened. What we need to do is basically using some of the technological tools to show or to bring the benefit of this integration towards our end user or our end learners. Now you see here, I am giving here in case of paradigm shift, what I actually meant for that. Here you see, I have given here two bars. You can see from here, blue bars and maroon bars. The blue bar indicates number of new print journal introduced in a given year covering all disciplines. So I have taken 91 to 2006, but because after 2006 the trend continues in the same way. So print journals indicated by the blue bar. So you see here in the 1991, the new print journal introduced in a given year is around 1500. The first online journal appeared in 1996, only 4 to 5 in number. But you see here the magic happened within 4 years. 96 it started. By 2000, that is within 4 years, it outnumbered the print journals, and you see the situation. Number of new online journal introduced in a given year goes up to 1000, whereas number of print journal reduced to 4 to 5. My point is here, the e-learning happened in that very moment when we shifted our focus. Our teaching learning evolution all are based on two important components. One is the journal, one is the book. Without books and journals, we are nothing. Just like doctors are nothing without medicine. So the paradigm shift already happened in these two main facets right from the 2001. And you see here how books are changing. So that was the journal. Now you see, it's a future projection of the book from the 2017 to 2020. Both the revenue generation and the number of users in two parts of this particular slide, you can see bottom part deals with the users and upper part deals with the e-book. So books are also changing their forms and formats. And if these two main vehicles of our scholarly communication process changing fundamentally in forms and formats, then it is going to affect our educational system, and it is going to affect the way we interact with our end learners, the way we impart different kind of training and education. So this future statistical from the reference is given. It's actually a good website to provide you different kind of future projection related to many things. E-book comes as a component. Now one silver line in the cloud is that another major trend of this scholarly process is that OCLC is considered as one of the main institute in our domain, in the domain of library services. And you all know about WorldCat, the largest cryptographic database of the world. And that OCLC conducted one research recently, and the research report published in 2018. So a kind of future prediction, although I do understand the prediction of future is a very risky business, but still you see here, we depend on some kind of future projection. What they clearly mentioned that particular report, that 47 to 50% resources are already available in the open access domain. So right from the beginning of the human civilization, the record of human civilization, what we have produced as a society so far, 50% of that knowledge, every article, every book is considered as a record of human civilization. And 50% of those records are already available in different open access channels. And by 2014, 100% will be available in different open access channels. Now, what is the significance of this particular report? The significance is that if you know different kind of sources, different kind of services related to open access channel, green path, gold path, bronze path, then possibly you will be having a specific piece of resource, and possibly you will be able to integrate that specific information resource inside your e-learning system on the basis of some kind of licensing, that is called Creative Commons licensing. Because every piece of open access object, object, if it is a book chapter or a journal paper or a full text, all are mostly available against licensing system. And that licensing do not restrict you like copyright, rather they gives you freedom to distribute, to redistribute, to adapt, to adapt, to paint, to use, and many things against some acknowledgement. Licensing system is called Creative Commons licensing system, and there are six variants of Creative Commons licensing system, and any one of these can guide your open access object, and that if it is supported with that of Creative Commons licensing, so any e-learning system can integrate this kind of resources inside the system. So that point of view, by 2040 everything will be open, everything will be in a position to be integrated inside an e-learning system, and we can do it if we are aware of different kind of sources and services. And library professional can help you to help and academia greatly in finding out, in discovering, in some different kind of open access resources, so that teachers and students can have it in the right format, in the right place, inside the e-learning system. So that is the future projection related to this one. So this is one factor how our two main vehicles of scholarly communication process is changing. But there are many other global factors. I will be coming to the Indian scenario later. There are many global factors related to with us. Population explosion. More people are alive, live, and in the entirety of human history put together. So what is the reason of raising this particular point? The reason is that as more people are available nowadays, so more and more people are attracted towards higher learning, towards research. So as a result, research object, progress of knowledge is actually becoming very dynamic. The rapid changes are coming everywhere because of the many people are actually attached with research and development process. Even in the pandemic situation, we have seen the research is moving. Every week we are getting new sets of information and which are completely different from the other information we already accumulated related to this particular virus. Second important thing related to e-learning is that information explosion. One particular internet research group, it's a very famous PEW. So they conducted or they actually reported back in a year back that every given an average human being is actually getting 10 gigabyte of textual data from different channels. Some of these are originated from scholarly channels like journal portal, blog posting, different other kind of things. Something is producing from the social networking channels, etc. But as a whole, we are getting in 1 minute 10 gigabyte of textual data. So it's basically an information explosion, and we simply don't know what to follow, what is authentication, or what is authenticated, and what not to follow. Third important factor is the information economy. In the history of human civilization, information never has been so important. And you see here, if you go through, if you look at this given moment, if you look around your surroundings, you will be seeing that 80% of the technologies actually around you related with information. Because never has technology been so focused on the access of information. Either that technology processing information or it is computing information. For example, I can give a number of examples right from your TV set to your smartphone in your home. But you see here, in the recent future, every electronic gadget in your household will be having an IP address. For example, in future, your fridge will be having an IP address, your microwave oven will be having an IP address, so that right from your office desk, you can communicate your microwave oven through your mobile phone and give instruction to start heating up or warming up the water because you have started from the office. Your directly place an order to your grocery shop that because of different kind of sensors. Say for example, in one rack you are keeping some kind of some sugar. The moment it is programmed like in this way, the moment the weight is less than 500 gram, it can send an email to the grocery shop for delivery of sugar to your home. So this kind of technologies are coming, and technologies are focusing on processing and accessing information. So as a result, what is happening, what I discussed so far, that your resources are becoming abundant. So, and many of these available in open access channels, so anyone can use it freely. More and more people are attracted towards research because our global population is going up. And different channels are there that can communicate information towards you. So as a result, what is happening, knowledge is actually rapidly changing almost every day. So as a teacher, what we teach our students in their very first year in the university or in college is outdated by the time they graduate. So what we people are teaching our very first year, that actually completely obsolete when passed out. So this way, how we teachers will cope up with the situation, and e-learning can be a solution for this particular dynamic changing of knowledge problem. So we are all fit to get on with it. That is a mandatory thing, because you like or not, change is the only permanent thing in this world. And the Darwin's once said that it is not the strongest of the species, or not even the wisest of the species. It is the species who will survive, which are most adaptable to the changes. So that we must remember, change already happened, and we need to adapt the changes. But one particular aspect I would like to talk about the e-learning process. The possible entire education system is actually changing. Say, for example, it has already been proved in this pandemic situation that for teaching learning evolution, we do not need buildings anymore. We do not, distance is not a barrier anymore. So in future, what will happen, as Peter Drucker, the management guru, who predicted 10 years back, the continuing professional education of adult will be the number one industry in the next 30 years. And that I also do believe. Because you see, the traditional learning will be ended somewhere. And in a knowledge society, every time you need to acquire new skills. So in future, it is coming that to survive in your work environment, to your academic environment, you need to learn many things in a given year. And there will be many such kind of informal courses will be going on in different interactive online mode. And that will be the number one industry in the next 30 years. And the symbol and sign is already there that lifelong learning is going to become the major facet of the main facet of education in future. And Alvin Toffler in 1981 said that in this, the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those people who cannot read or write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. That is very important for a teacher, for an academia, or library professional attached with e-learning environment. You need to learn quickly, you need to unlearn quickly, and you need to relearn quickly. So learn and relearn, you understand. But what is unlearn? What you need to forget something, what you have already learned. Because, you see, let me give you one example. Say, you are using a particular word processing software. Most of us use it for writing letter, for writing articles, etc. Now, when the new version came, you see, I have utilized that particular software for the last 10 years. The new version came up with lot of new features, with lot of new changes. Then I need to learn the previous version first to learn the new version properly. Otherwise, every time the older version will pull me back towards that particular event. Okay, this particular icon was previously was there, now it is here. So this kind of unlearning is now associated with all kind of facets. Another example from academic world, I can say that we need to formulate different kind of factual process related to what, why, how, who, etc. Now in the e-learning environment, that kind of question has no meaning in fact, because that kind of questions, what we said normally in question, discuss, describe, explain, etc., is very much related to the protected examination system. But in an e-learning system, you are not dealing with the, or you are not having the facility of protected examination system. So in that particular environment, everything under the sun, every resource under the sun are available in the hand of your student. So we need to learn how to form the open-ended question in place of the factual question. So we need to unlearn first the question, the habits of question formulation in the traditional learning environment. Then we need to relearn that how to frame the open-ended question. So that kind of things are going on every facets of teaching learning evaluation. Now you already have a global scenario related to ongoing global scenario in the learning process. Now let us come back to Indian higher education system, that why Indian higher education system badly needs e-learning. So one factor is that I will be dealing with three factors. So let us start with higher education in India general scene. Then demographic demand, another new concept came recently, and the budget of higher education. So if you go through the latest All India Survey of Higher Education report 2018-19, that was the latest one. It says, in this particular report, it says, we are having one of the biggest educational system of the world. But unfortunately, this is not the finest. Now, according to that report, almost 1,000 universities, 40,000 colleges, 10,000 plus standalone institutions, one third of the universities and colleges rightly located in the rural areas. So what are the ailing factors of this large educational system? I will be talking about three ailing factors. One is the college density. If you want to have a greater, closer look, you can download the All India Survey of Higher Education report. The references at the bottom of this slide, and the slide I will be sharing with you, all of you, all the participants. So don't worry about the references and other things. So if you go through the entire report of All India Survey of Higher Education, you will see we are one of the biggest system, but there are some ailing factors. So first ailing factor is the college density. The average college density in our country is 28. So what do we mean by college density? College density means number of colleges we are providing for 1 lakh of eligible people. Who are the eligible people? People belonging to the age group of 18 to 23. So on an average, we have 28 colleges per lakhs of eligible people in India. But this college density varies a great within the country. For example, if you go to the Bangalore urban district of Karnataka, the college density is as high as 80. If you come to Jharkhand, the college density, or Chhattisgarh even, the college density is as low as 7. So that means in Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh, we have 7 colleges per lakhs of eligible people. Whereas in Bangalore urban district, we have 80 colleges for 1 lakhs of eligible people. So this is the unevenness inside the educational system of India. Next, problem is the student progression. The student progression of India is only 0.5%. What do we mean by student progression? So student progression, students is actually becoming part and moving towards the PG level and finally doctoral level. So that progression rate is quite low, 0.5%. In India, we are providing 187 programs. These 1,000 universities, 40,000 colleges, altogether they provide 187 program. But do you know 50% of our students are actually taking up only 10 programs? So 10 programs only takes 80% of the students, and mostly these 10 programs belonging to the arts, humanities and social science. But if you statistics related to the PhD degree holder, the last year almost 1,69,000 people awarded PhD, and 90% of the PhD holders are actually belonging to the STEM group, science, technology, engineering and management. So this is again a fallacy. Chunk of the student, majority of our students are going to arts, humanities or social science, and that to only 10-12 program. But most of the PhD holders coming out belong to the STEM group. So student progression is very low, only 0.5%. But the greatest of all this ailing factor is the gross enrollment ratio. Now what is gross enrollment ratio? You all know. So I'm talking about GTER, gross enrollment ratio in tertiary education. So here you see the national average is only 26.3 as per the latest report. But again, you see the disparity, the unevenness. If you go to the Delhi NCR zone, it goes up to 50.6. If you come down to the southern part of our country, every state in the southern India are actually higher than the national average, led by the Tamil Nadu with 49.0. But interestingly, if you go through the entire western, central and eastern India, we people are basically pulling India back as far as GER is concerned. West Bengal, the gross enrollment ratio GER is 19.3 only, or the national average is 26.3. So entire western, central and eastern India, some of the northeastern states are doing very good, like 33.7, 53.9, but some are not doing so good. So entire situation is very bad in case of Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh and Assam. So that is the thing happening. We have low GER, and that is not the only ailing factor. The GER is greatly uneven from Delhi NCR zone in comparison to Chhattisgarh. We are actually in the range of 50.6 to 13.6. So it's a wide gap exists. So these are the healing factors, and I will be establishing the factor that how these factors are actually leading us towards the e-learnings. Now let's compare gross enrollment ratio with the comparable countries. So we have taken only four Asian countries: India, South Korea, Japan, and China. You see here the green line. We all started almost same. You see, right in the decade of 70s, we all started in the almost same position. But South Korea, you see, made a quantum jump and they reach up to 80 very quickly. But it's a very small country. It's not comparable to India. So next comes Japan. They have almost 60th GER. And here you see the red line indicates China and saffron line indicates India. India started better than China and continued up to 1994. In 1994, China made a quantum jump and they now reached up to 49.3, whereas we are still struggling with 26.3. Why I am giving so emphasis on Graves' gross enrollment ratio? Because you are going for your traditional learning or relearning. Ultimately, the success depends on the number of enrollment, and not only on the number of enrollment, the the continuation, the percentage of students continuing that particular process. So please be very aware of this particular low GER of India. And you see the after effect of GER, low GER. We took up the Scopus database, the bibliographic database you all know, the world famous. So 25 years we actually studied. In that 25 years, United States produced 120 million research papers. In the domain of education, the success is always measured what we are contributing back to the knowledge pool. That is in the form of research articles. So research articles measures the success of an educational system of a given country. And here you see, India still manages top 20 position, but in the 25 years, we produced only 60.70 million paper, whereas US produced 120 million paper, China comes a distant second, 60 million paper. So this is directly related to our low gross enrollment ratio. If we fail to attract people inside our UT classes, our PG classes, our higher education, then how can you expect that people will join the research pool and produce the good research and contributing back to the knowledge pool? So we need to improve our gross enrollment ratio. If you go through the new educational policy published recently, they are planning to raise the gross enrollment ratio up to 50 within 6 years. That's an impossible task because we are presently running almost half, 26.3. But you see, one good factor is that now government of India understand the importance of gross enrollment ratio in higher education. So that actually again leading all the road towards e-learning. Now the second important factor what I am going to tell you as a teacher you need to know, that is the demographic dividends or demographic bonus. What is a demographic dividends or bonus? When in a given country, it's a very rarely comes, this particular chance comes very rarely for a country, only after 500 or 700 years. So when working age population of a given country is larger than the non-working age, what do we mean by that? Working age population, that is the people of the age group of 15 to 64, and non-working or dependent population is children below 14 and our senior citizens. Sixty-five and older. So here demographic bonus means working age population is larger than the non-working. So in India, the median age is 28.1, you see here. And whereas the median age, for Japan is 47.3, China is 37.4 and so on. So median age, actually by median age, India, it is one of the lowest, global median age. That means India is possibly will be the youngest of the world in the future, and most of the workforce what we are going to supply, because already nations are becoming aged. So in Japan, in Asia, they are already an aged nation. In Germany, in Europe, already an aged nation. So we are, an average Indian is 10 years younger than a Chinese counterpart. China, it is 37.4. So this opportunity is called the demographic bonus, where our youth force of population is considerable and significant, and our working age share is higher than the non-working age share. Now, many countries enjoyed demographic bonus or demographic dividend earlier. For example, Japan started enjoying this in 1964. Up to 2004, they enjoyed 40 years, and the spectacular growth made by Japan, you all know. If you come to China, for China, it started in 1994. Do you remember I said that China made a quantum jump in gross enrollment ratio in 1994? Because government China actually understood this particular fact, this demographic bonus, this favorable demographics of the country. They started investing, restructuring their higher education, started increasing their gross enrollment ratio right from the 1994. They entered in the demographic dividend era. So 1994, for them, it will be ending by 2031. So they have also got the same 37 years of window like India. So for India, we already lost 2 years. For India, it started in 2018. That's why I have given median age in 2018. And it will be ending by 2055. So by the grace of the God, we got a 37 years of window for, you know, this kind of demographic bonus. And in the bottom part of the slide, you can see how our, you know, non-working age share is diminishing, and our working age share is increasing from 2018 to 2050. And after 2055, again our dependent population ratio will be increasing. So again, this particular demographic bonus leads us to the e-learning. Why I will be coming. But please remember, the demographic bonus is not the only thing for the better. You need to invest a lot, if you take care of this, demographic bonus. Because working age population needs to be actually working. They need to be employable. They need to have skills to, handle different kind of jobs related to 21st century. So if they are not employable, if they do not have skills to survive, what they will do? There are many kind of social unrest will be awaiting for us in future if we fail to channelize this youth force inside our educational challenge, if we fail to import the skills related to face different kind of 21st century jobs. And now I am coming to the budget of higher education, another bottleneck related to our educational system. Here you see from 2014-15 financial year to 2017-18 financial year, the percentage of educational expenditure is rapidly diminishing from 6.8% to 3.71%. But at the same time, budget is decreasing, but government has taken interrelated projects to promote e-learning in the country. All these projects are related and finally going towards the better higher educational system, online higher educational system. So one is called NAD, National Academic Depository. In future, most of the marksheets and certificates will be available, will be downloadable through NAD repository, just like our students now download their NAT and SET marksheet from the web server. Similarly, all certificate and marksheet won't be available from the university. University will provide the input to the NAD, and from NAD it will be available. This is related to the easiness of the global transcriptions process. Because if we are targeting the global job market, and this is a very important thing, that our global employer must, check the credentials over the online process of transcription. Then comes the two interrelated e-learning project. One is called Swayam, another is called Swayamprabha. Both of you know, Swayam is the web-based MOOCs, massive open online courses, and Swayamprabha is a direct-to-home television, which basically providing the content of SWAYAM over the DTH network. Now, Project Imprint and Project Aria are funding teachers for different innovative projects related to e-learning, different kind of, you know, frontier areas of their subject. These two projects are doing very good. In fact, many NME ICT based projects, many, you know, new project, many e-learning initiative. Then NIRF, you all know, this ranking system is required to attract the foreign students in our higher educational system. And recently, Ministry of HRD came with an innovative program called Know Your College. With the advent of this particular portal, every college now can have their web presence through Ministry of HRD, Know Your College portal. But these seven programs are running hand by hand, putting e-learning, but our budget is decreasing. And here you see, if we calculate our budget against as percentage of our GDP, this is also decreasing like anything. In 2014-15, it was 0.53, and in 2019-20, it reduced to 0.45. So this is, on the one hand, we need huge investment, huge infrastructure restructuring in the higher education because we need to achieve a higher growth enrollment ratio, but our budget is sinking. And all these are leading us towards the all ailing factors, as I discussed, like here, low GER, inequality, shortage of educators, unemployable youth, low student population, low higher education budget, towards the e-learning system. As I said, e-learning is here not as a plan B of pandemic situation, because this is the only low-cost solution which can change India from inside out. It has all the possibilities, all the, you know, facets to reach to the unreached. Now you see, in a remote village in Arunachal Pradesh, last week, Professor P.P. Chakravarti, the ex-director of IIT Kharagpur, posted one news that one particular village in Arunachal Pradesh, one particular boy of 8th standard, going through different interactive lectures given by IIT professors in C programming, and came up with a very good solution at the class 9. So this kind of facilities, you are providing the best of the business teachers, your IIT teachers, your NIT teachers, your Central University teachers, ISAT teachers, their video learning, their skills, their knowledge to the, you know, remotest village of India through networking, through e-learning. So that is the only solution, because we cannot set an IIT in Arunachal Pradesh or in Tripura or in remote part of Sundarban, but we can always provide business teachers teaching, learning, evaluation skills to the remotest part of our village. So that's why Government of India are projecting e-learning in such a big way. So what they proposed actually before entering in, because your hands-on sessions will be starting from tomorrow, as I understand. So before that, you need to keep in mind two important factors what Government of India, Ministry of HRD proposed. They proposed one technical architecture, another is the content architecture. So first I am going through the technical. And as I said previously, that e-learning is not simply everything. ICT-enabled learning system, digital learning, virtual learning, and managed learning. And I will show you as a proof of concept that what is managed learning. So these are the options, and possibly blended learning is a judicious mixture of this e-learning system alongside your traditional learning. Okay. Now this blended learning process is actually survive for the next 5-6 years, because in one fine morning you cannot start your virtual learning or managed learning coming 2-3. We need to astutely mix up our traditional classroom based teaching learning process alongside different forms of e-learning. I have mentioned here daily MLE or MOOCs. MOOCs is basically a kind of virtual learning, but here virtual learning is meant for a single institution or a group of institution, whereas MOOCs is meant for a national level, where many universities can join together to provide any number of courses and to accommodate any number of learners. So the platform is huge, but it's nothing but originally a virtual learning environment, and you know already the MOOCs movement all over the world. But first thing you need to remember very attentively in your e-learning endeavor, that every e-learning process, be it DLE, VLE, MED, MOOCs, everything actually centers on the top of DLO, that is digital learning objects. Now, what is a digital learning object? How does it differ from our traditional learning object? The digital learning objects are that can be repurposed, that can be received. For example, one of the PowerPoints like Tirtho may use in this particular e-learning program. Again, some of the things developed by Tirtho, I can utilize in my e-learning system because of, we can repurpose, we can resequence this digital learning object if available with a set of metadata and with a set of license. So suppose I'm giving you an example. You are preparing a PowerPoint slides to teach your students. The learning object, but still it is not a digital learning object. Why? Although it is available in the soft copy, but that learning object, when attached to set of metadata, sort of metadata schema, LRMI is there, IEEE LOM is there, SCOM is there. So some LRMI is now most popular, Learning Resource Metadata Initiative. So on the basis of LRMI, you have to fill up a set of fields. Who developed it? It's intended for discussion. What are the prerequisites required to follow this particular material? What is the time requirement? What the hardware requirement? So all this kind of metadata when associated with it, and any form of Creative Commons licensing. That means you are giving it to you are not actually holding the rights. You are giving rather the rights to the learners. Copyleft movement and supported by Creative Commons licensing system. So there are six variants. The most liberal is CC0. One is the CC BY-NC-ND. That means you are providing that one, but not for commercial purposes. NC, not for non-derivative purpose. That means no one can derive anything, or that on the basis of your e-learning object, they cannot provide their own e-learning system. So that kind of licensing agreement is there, but it all gives one particular fact is common. It always promotes the freedom of the distribution, freedom of read, freedom of write, freedom of distribution, freedom of redistribution. So digital learning objects are those which are the smallest units of your teaching learning, supported by a set of metadata and supported by a set of life. When this actually becomes the central focus of an e-learning, then that can be accessed with different kinds of structure, different kind of virtual communication tools, as I said before, asynchronous tools and synchronous tools. Now, VLE we already covered. One of the beautiful definition given by Lord Hillard, VLE is a growing and dynamic environment in which education is changing culturally, institutionally and technically. Now, how does it differ from your traditional learning environment? That is also very important to note. And here lies the role of library resources inside the VLE or MLE. So here you see in VLE and MLE, one of the distinct factor is that here learning materials and resources are available within the system. In a traditional learning environment, classroom and libraries are two different entities. The moment your class is over, you are giving a set of references, your student goes to the library, they search the materials, having the materials and coming back to join the, that gone are the days for that kind of separable unit-based approach. In VLE and MLE, your learning material, references you are referring as a teacher, all must be available within the system. Here lies the great scope of grand unification of informatics. And here we are going for online assessment, here examination, protected examinations rather. Another important factor is that VLE is a user-driven time and learning schedule. My student can repeat my class, one of my class for many times until and unless he or she is totally through. But here you see here we are going for institute driven time and learning system, and we rather follow a factory model of education in traditional learning. It may appear as I am slightly rude when I am saying educational institute is basically a factory model, but why I am saying so, you see, we nowadays what we do inside an educational institute, we bring our raw materials, that is our student, we process them in classrooms, and then finally send them to the job market. You see, the factory also does the same thing. They bring the raw material, they process inside the machine, and they for the market for selling. So that factory model of education is gradually replacing time and learning system, and it will be user-centric learning system in future through online learning. Here in the traditional learning, we have only classroom. I simply do not know what my student is doing beyond classroom, what problems they are facing. But here you see, VLE can be attached with different kind of communication tools, discussion forum, wikis, blogs, chat, video conferencing, and many many more things actually. And here it supported the sophisticated monitoring and tracking. In module what you are going to learn, there is a plugin called TinaCAN. In TinaCAN, applying TinaCAN plugin inside, I can even know in which particular frame, in which particular second, my student actually withdrew himself or herself from my video tutorial. Then I can check what went wrong in this particular frame or in that particular given minute, so that I can rectify. So in this kind of sophisticated tracking, monitoring, every second based tracking and monitoring is there. But in a traditional learning environment, we are only having registers, tutor records, etc. So here I am not in a position to entirely promote VLE over the TLE, but my suggestion is that there are some factors associated with the managed learning and virtual learning which are not quite available in traditional learning. Similarly, some of the interesting things available with the traditional learning, the sense of witness of a teacher in a classroom, the informal talk with the students in the corridor. So that kind of things will be missing in virtual. But instead, virtual learning is also providing many new things which you cannot apply inside your traditional learning environment. Now, the technical architecture Government of India proposing or giving a full-layer architecture for a university who is actually interested to develop this kind of equipment. So at the core of the core is not e-learning. You see here, at the core of the core is the learning object repository. So what the plan is that, suppose Vishwanath is going to have e-learning system, virtual learning or managed learning in future. So first they need to create a learning object repository. All digital learning objects like your lecture notes, like your video, like PowerPoint slides, everything will be up. Permitting proper licensing. Then you see, this will be acting as the hub and these are acting as the spoke. So what do I mean by that? Like learning content management system like Moodle, your content management system like faculty management system like Koha, so what you are using, all can be integrated and your user can interact with e-learning through any kind of interface. Someone may go through the LCMS, may come through the LMS, someone may come through the CMS. So everything will be attached with each other through different kind of interoperable standards, and that interoperable standard called LT, Learn Tools Interop, and will show you in live demonstration mode how this actually works. So it will be integrated, but at the center there will be LOR. So this is just a component of this process. Do not think this is the main thing. Only the front end or end user level interface which supports teaching learning environment, but it cannot, Moodle or any kind of LCMS cannot act as a digital learning object repository system, but that is very much needed. For example, if you see the process of IGNU, what IGNU did, they first developed eGANCourse is basically a learning object repository, and finally they opened it up for the entire world, where IGNU actually archived all of their course materials, their teaching learning materials. Then they started their LCMS in the front end. So LCMS just a front end. At the core of the code, you need to have an LOR, learning object repository. And all this can be interrelated with each other. But the more important thing as a teacher who are participating here is basically not the technical lecture. That's a one-time solution. And what I mentioned here, because of the reason that some of you may go for your technical architecture for your college or institution. Now, at the content level architecture, a new model or model given on the basis of the Swayam ecosystem by the government of India, and that model, what I am going to discuss here, is called the four quadrant model. And as a teacher, you must learn it very deeply, with great intensity, intensity, because I'm getting some noise. Hello. Audio is clear to all of you. I'm getting some noise from that end.
We are also getting some noise.
Okay. So wait for some.
We are also getting noise.
Let's wait a bit. Maybe someone not unmuted. Okay, now it's okay. Okay. I said that the model, the content architecture level model by the proposed by the Ministry of HRT, you need to follow. If you are really do something, if you really want to learn something in the domain of e-learning, you need to set your mind in this four quadrant approach. And if understand at the end of the day you have learnt Moodle and you have implemented it, but you are not following four quadrant model, then that particular thesis is considered as e-learning. And the, all the API related marks, then nowadays they have allotted huge marks related, e-learning. So if you are developing e-learning object, if for every e-learning object you will be getting 5 marks in the API. So that won't be possible if so you are like to request you the curricula or your syllabus of any given semester or any given course. Now, if you visualize your syllabus, you can see your syllabus curriculum includes number of courses. So those are called, we normally call those things papers. In a CBCS system, we call them courses. If you go through a particular course against a particular course number, you can see that course include number of units. So if you come down to the units, you can see that most of the units are including different, topics. So a set of topic list, it may range 5, 6, 7, 8 or so on. So you need to target those topics in a given course. Suppose you are teacher of a given course, XYZ. In the XYZ course, there is a three units, unit 1, unit 2, unit 3. So you need to go through the unit 1, I'm covering suppose unit 1, so there are 5 topics. So I need to target a single topic of that particular unit. Now against that particular topic, I need to produce 4 components or 4 parameters. So what are that 4 components? That is called 4 quadrant. Quadrant 1 is video tutorial. I need to record a video, 27 minute to 30 minute video on the given topic, which explains that topic very lucidly for my end learners. Or if I am not in a position to develop that video tutorial, use the video tutorial. There lies the purpose of digital learning object. They are that can be repurposed. If I know one of my already developed that one available under Creative Commons licenses, that I can directly integrate in my e-learning system as quadrant one. So either you can develop your, or you can take up your colleagues and friends who already working on this particular area, not only locally but also globally. I'm showing you some of the remarkable, classroom, repository where you can download many of these things. So quadrant one, you need to have a YouTube tutorial or video tutorial. In the quadrant two, you have to prepare an e-text, a summary, 8 to 10 pages with proper further reading list, or a slide presentation, or both. So quadrant one is basically related with the e-content. Either you can have 8 to 10 pages summary on that particular given topic, or a slide presentation, or both of these. Now, quadrant three, where your librarian friends can help you a lot. In quadrant three, we need to give a set of references, and Government of India categorically said that the further reading list must be based on open access resources as far as feasible. Because you see, is the topic, I am giving all 10, 15 resources for further readings, all are commercial object, not available in the open access channel, and my library do not have it, my library do not subscribe that particular journal. So what is the point of giving that particular reference? My student cannot access it. So to ensure the access of further reading objects, you need to provide open access resources, another chance of grand unification of e-learning and open access resources or the informatics. And quadrant four is basically related to the evaluation part. So all three facets, teaching, learning and evaluation, are covered by four quadrant. Quadrant four is the self-assessment or MCQ based testing or short answer type testing. Itself supports not many types of MCQ tests. In case of our SAT and NET examination, we know up to 4 or 5 types of MCQ, but Moodle supports around 3 dozens of MCQ types, and you can go for different kind of video content based comprehension test, audio content based comprehension test, and many more things. So as I said again, so these are the 4 quadrant learning. So this is all about the theoretical part what I need to cover. Now let me go through different kind of channels and show you something in demonstration mode. So please report me, you can see my browser here or not. Please someone report me. Can browser?
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Fine. So before making a quantum jump inside the our demonstration system, let me tell you something about the resources which are very much available inside the e-learning system. One is called let us start with tool. I know that Nima will cover any of these tools in his topic, but let me show some of the newer tools which can help you to integrate this thing. This is search engine developed by a group of librarians, and in one place you have 237 million open access resources. It is developed by the Central Library of Bielefeld University. I am also a member of this particular team, and it is based on an open source software called ViewFind, and the content is also available. So we are all moving O3 libraries, O3 library system in the world: open source, open standards, and open content. So this is one of the example how libraries are supporting e-learning. Base includes 237 of resources, and why I am talking about this, because I am going to show you that how we can integrate this huge resources, huge search engine inside our e-learning system in the MLE environment. So the next important things are coming, that is Rains.org, another great site. So I know that many of the college libraries and some of the university libraries also, they do not go for the subscription of bibliographic database like Scopus, EBSCOhost, Web of Science, etc. So I'm giving you a very low cost alternative, or G zero-cost alternative against Postscopus, developed by a group of, again, a group of librarian and scholars from different parts of the world. That is called lens.org. So you can see this is the website address, lens.org. And this is for base-search.net. So these two websites I'm going to show you to integrate. This, you see here, it's a bibliographic database. Suppose searching something here. I'm searching a very simple web scale. So here you see what I'm going to show you here. It's not a straightforward, you know, retrieval system where you will search and it will retrieve. So just like your, something it is giving which is not available inside Scopus event. So here you see some of the against my query related to actually retrieved how many documents retrieved almost Now you see here, these are the resources. Now I go for different kind of relevance ranking. Say I want to display only the document, the retrieved document, such a way that object which received the highest citation should go to the top. So I can click scholarly citation highest. So now it will arrange all the objects as per the citation received those things. And here you see, right from here, it can tell you which is open access. So here, apart from this tool, it can tell you that this is available open access and this is the link to the full text, almost a library like, you know, interface. And not only that particular factor, in the right hand side, you can see it can give you the other things related to the one is the list. And if I click the analysis, you see it rapidly analyzed all the retrieved documents of the document, who are the most producing productive institutes in this particular domain, how scholarly works related to web scale actually started in which year and how it is reaching the top and how the S-curve is doing, what are the different kind of publishing types associated, what are the top fields of studies related to web scale, and what are the most prolific, who are the most prolific researcher or most active authors in this domain. So apart from retrieving lot many, you know, open access based or scholarly resources, you are also getting a scope analyze all the papers is retrieved against your query. In Scopus, this kind of facility is not there. So let us go for the, these are actually, you know, things happening. Many such tools are there, but Dr. Nimai Chal Saha will be covering all this, so I'm not going to details. What I'm trying to show you here, this is our e-learning system. And believe it or not, we have not spent a single paisa in developing this resource. After learning Moodle, you need a platform. Either you can install Moodle locally because it's an open source software. It is, you can have a LAMP architecture or rather AMP architecture, XMP architecture. X can be any operating system. Then Apache, MySQL, PHP, So Moodle, what I am saying is that you can install locally. It is based on the XMP architecture. You can have your Windows operating system or Linux operating system, and you can install it locally. Or if you do not want to take that pain, so you can always start in this particular site. So this is called moodlecloud.com. So here you see, this is the site moodlecloud.com. You can start a particular course freely. We are running two courses in Moodle Cloud. The recent demand, exorbitant rise on the demand of Moodle Cloud. So they restricted the free courseware for 45 days only. So if you want to run a permanent Moodle course, Moodle Plus, now it is not the this issue now. In place of that, what we are using as a course, that is called Genomeo.com. Genomeo.com is available for where you can start your Moodle courses free of cost for indefinite period of time. They are giving you 500 registered users can you can accommodate 50 users at a time you can handle. But there are two limitations. One limitation is that they will pop up some advertisement, because they cover up all the expenses against advertisement. Most of the advertisements are related to education only, so don't worry about that. So next is that you cannot install any plugin. So basic plugins you cannot install. Everything, almost everything they have given, you don't need also any extra thing. But if you want to experiment something again, given plugin, that it is not possible in Genomeo. So these two limitations are there, but the rest of all things are quite interesting. As I said, that if you can go to Genomeo.com, here let me show you that. And they are hosting the latest version of Moodle, I checked, that is 3. So this is the Genomeo site. Now here, easy it is. You just give your virtual host name or domain name, it will create a site for you, your email ID, and you are ready. So this, it's a service cloud actually. You are giving your name of the site, and it is creating if your email is already not registered with them. So that simple way you can start your Moodle service. So starting a Moodle, installing a Moodle is not a big business. The big business is how to handle Moodle. So let me show you some of the things. So let me enter inside my system. So I am, in many of the cases I know, this is invariably, I forget my password every time. I don't know why. What is happening? This time it was with the user system. Okay, hopefully it will work. Our e-learning portal we are running for all the semester, and here you see this kind of advertisement will be popping up. So if you cannot restrict that, so you have to leave it with up, because you are running almost an entire coursework free of cost. So let me go to the site of here you see first created hierarchy. So this is the LIS coursework for all four semester we have entered it. Let us say I go to the final semester courses. In any of the final semester courses, if I click here, you see it's basically a hierarchical option. First you set your category as your course, then you go for different kind of semester. Under each semester you can have subcategories like different kind of courses. Now here you see the fourth semester, I am running their four papers as a teacher, and all the five papers are available. If you having six papers this semester, so one paper I am not attached that at all, so I have not given here. So let us go to any of this learning service platform. So seeing is believing. You can enter working or looks like. So my suggestion is that you can create sections in your system. My suggestion is that in general you can include different kind of resources, different kind of activities which can initially your students will not be e-learning friendly. So you can create lot many interesting tasks which can slowly attract them towards e-learning. One such talk productive is a collaborative glossary. So in the section one, you see I have not yet started my course before that, what I start is basically a collaborative glossary. Moodle provides you the opportunity to create a glossary. Then you can invite your students to interact with the glossary. What I do, I can share with you. What I do in this particular course, that is the course is actually library service platform. I collect, I have collected a set of 50 code terms. So that particular terms, a few I have defined. So what does it mean? Two line or three line, you know, scope determination of a given term, just like a glossary, a list of technical terms. Then I invited my students that each of you need to create your own 5 terms in the domain library service platform, and you need to define 5 existing terms what I have given. So that is a very good exercise for them. And as you know, Moodle has an inbuilt plugin checking capability, UniCheck. So we use the free version of the UniCheck, and I told them that no one please copy, because I can easily guess right from here my UniCheck. I have shown that them an example that what not to do and what need to follow, and they come up with excellent LSP glossary. So they particular system, a glossary, and here you see who created this particular term and glossary, all written there. So they become contributor. So you are upgrading their status from learner to contributor. And do not forget that this kind of interactive e-learning will be slightly different from traditional learning environment, where your learner, your researcher, your students are basically acting as a co-developer. So some of the very interesting suggestions I received from my students and implemented them. So this kind of glossary, when they can see that I have developed this particular thing and it is accessible throughout the world, so they will be very much motivated. They will become part of your initiative rather. So this one, I think, so in this fashion you can start one wiki also. You can start, so I have started with the term glossary, so you can start with article. So you need to write one paragraph on this particular concept, and again you can integrate Moodle with UniCheck to check the plagiarism, and you tell them, you just do not terrorize them, you just motivate them that these are the value system, you are part of a legacy system, then this is the academic honesty, is a academic integrity is a part of the value system, what need to do. And so you just prepare a do and do not list, they will understand very easily. Different kind of chat box you can create. So after each of the classes, I create a chat room. So this is a chat room already inbuilt inside Moodle, you don't have to do anything. So I can click that. So this can be very effective for your doubt clearing session. So after a class is over, normally I open a chat box, I give announce the chat room time, that from this time to that time I will be available inside the chat room. Students join me, they can discuss topic, and we can have a group chat related to different aspects. It's a very important device for your different kind of doubt clearing session. So these are all available inside the activity you will be learning. Now if we come to the unit 1 of my course, you can see it is not mandatory. This is the unit, I have given the all the topics of the unit first, and what I normally follow, it is not mandatory that you have to start with quadrant 1. Conceptually, you need to include 1, 2, 3 and 4 quadrant in your system. I always start with quadrant 3, and it has got a unique advantage. What is quadrant 3? Quadrant 3 is the further reading list for your student. So I give them a set of 4 resources available as open access resource, what they can go through, different kind of resources related with this. So I started with, suppose, library ecosystem. Then they go through all the essential reading, and finally the major reading list. Now after that one, my actual discussions of topic related things started. So I have covered the quadrant 3, that is the list of further reading. Then I have started the quadrant 2. You see here, I have not yet started quadrant 1. So what is quadrant 2? The e-text on your topic. So the topic is ILS track 1. So I have added one. embedded, and you try better to embed always your PDF file, always keep your document PDF file including your slide, so that will become software portable. That means if I am using, suppose you have given PPT, I am using a Linux system, I cannot open. I have given you ODP, you are using a Windows system, that cannot be opened. So always try to convert your slides and text in PDF format. That's got an advantage. Even your students can easily open it up in their smartphone. Because nowadays e-learning is becoming multimodal and multinodal. So this is why for 8 to 10 pages of summary on the topic, and I have given a list of further reading. Here another additional system you need is basically how to tackle the reference management subsystem, like Zotero is there, Mendeley is there. So by using that tool you can create a list citation standard format. Here I have followed the APA format. So in the APA format I created further reading list and attached to it. So now when my students actually covered that particular reading, they can go for the presentation. And both of these actually belong to the quadrant one conceptually. You don't have to write this is quadrant one, quadrant two. Thus, it's a conceptual content architecture. And now they can go presentation. Here in submitting, the presentation in PDF format will be coming one by one. In one slide by one slide, you can download. They can interact with it, they can write different kind of comments and many other things you can do with this slides. It's taking slightly time, okay. So this is the interface, they can zoom in, they can zoom out, etc. And they can go for different kind of presentation. Exactly in slide format it will be appearing, and it's completely as it is following the bootstrap, this CSS format, so it is completely compatible with your mobile phone also. Don't worry about that. Now, so my quadrant 3 and quadrant 1 is over. Now, what we normally do with the quadrant 1? That is possibly the most difficult part of a teacher. So I need to record a particular video on the given topic, that is the ILS in transition related to library service platform. So normally what I do, I took the help of, as I am attached very much with the IGNU people, I took the advantage of their multimedia studio, but because of this pandemic situation now I cannot do that. So I also will advise you that you better learn the OBS system. OBS stands for Open Broadcasting Studio. OBS is an open source software, video tutorial, video capturing software available free of cost. It can run on both Windows environment as well as in Linux environment. So by using that OBS, you can prepare your video tutorial. Video tutorial should not exceed the length of 35 minutes. So try to limit between the 27 minutes to 35 minutes. Now, after your video is ready, you open up on behalf of your college, on behalf of your institutes, or on your personal behalf, a YouTube channel. YouTube channel, very good in streaming, but I prefer Vimeo channel as it is slightly academic in nature. Because in YouTube, sometimes, at the end of the your video is over, and then some kind of inappropriate videos may come. There is a chance always. But in case of Vimeo, that is not going to happen anything because Vimeo is completely academic. So they work in the both the same way. So after that video tutorial I have prepared, what I did, I embedded that video tutorial inside my Moodle. So one lesson one is that do not try to utilize hosted system, local Moodle system. You don't try to upload your video there, because video streamings are different ball game. If you utilize your computer as a video streaming server as well as a learning content management system server, then definitely it's going to fail. Video streaming, always use other video streaming server like Vimeo and YouTube, and you can easily embed this system inside your your e-learning system. Let me show you first how it is happening, then I'll show how we can embed this one. So you can see here it is coming from YouTube now, and the streaming is there, and my student can increase the size, they can control that, go forward anytime, any number of times they can. Sound quality. Welcome to the tutorial on major trends and future of library automation. In this particular tutorial, so I can move forward any classific point. So in this way, you can always utilize. Now you see. Now let us have how we have embedded this particular system. If we go to the edit setting, you can see here. YouTube always provide you a system. Which is called that you can click the share button. It will give you an embed link, embedded HTML link. Now in the embedded the content page, what I did you see? I have just embedded that particular what actually provided by YouTube. So you see. It's iframe to iframe. I have created a center panel, tag in HTML. Little bit of HTML will always be beneficial. Try to learn it, but there are many websites available which what HTML. Here I have given the in the center position that things what produced by the YouTube, and here you see the result. Go back. This is the result of this embed. It's a very simple thing. You can, if you are using videos prepared by some other people, always check the copyright and always give the copyright statement at the notice part. You are through. This is all about the all three quadrants related. The teaching learning, and now I am coming to the evaluation part. It's a very simple to create different kind of assignment. So this is now my quadrant three. Quadrant four is starting. That is the assignment part. Assignment one, two, and three I have given. They can submit their online assignment and different kind of MCQ one, two, and everything available. So after this, this MCQ test and assignment test is over, you can create your grade book. Depending the weight, different kind of thing. That gradebook you can create for the every unit related to the weightage of the things. So I created a 50 marks weightage, and I have given I published the result of unit one. Then the it's a very average you determine that what particular. Component of the system carries how what the voltage what carry there you can easily create your this thing now and the, in this way we can go on and at course I prepare complete grade book. So this is the grade book related to all covering all units of this particular course. So total 100 marks except we have taken the result we have said we send to our controller of examination system alongside you can download the entire format your CSV format and many other formats are available. HTML table format you can download. So this is all about a particular course. Now you see the grade here I have just shown you the straightforward process how easy it is to create and prepare an offer. Now I am trying to show you a particular course which integrated as a proof of concept in learning environment. So I am now going to my semester two courses. In a semester, two courses. One particular course I am running, which is called resource description. Now, if you remember the earlier course, you can easily distinguish this course from earlier course. You see in the right hand side, I have given number of services. So this is my library service, the local library service. This is my library discovery service. This is related to the IntCAT, the Union Catalog of Indian Universities, WorldCAT, World Union Catalog running by OCLC. And here you see, I have shown you one of the search engine called Base, another is Lens. Now you see, suppose this is a course of cataloging. And my student, as I said, that students, libraries are nowadays integral part of this e-learning. Library of the e-learning system, and it must have presence here. So you see here, my student don't have to go outside the system. Now suppose they want to know, it's a course on cataloging, they want to know, Sarah was talking about FRBR, so what is FRBR? Let us have some MIT document. So they can go for the full text search here, click, and here you see they're not leaving the system. Inside that system, that is the proof of concept related to managed learning environment. Managed learning environment means your different subsystems of the institution, like your library system as a whole. I have taken just the library system because I know I understand that topic. So that's why I started with the library system. And here you see the same base search engine, what I have shown you so far, it's actually popping up the result related to FRBR. And I boosted the result in such a way that all the open access resources will pop up fast. So my student is having my content as well as they are getting support from Base and many other search engines right from here. They can click it, they can read it, and they don't have to again come back to my system. Just simply off the system. So now we integrated Lens. We are in the process of integrating many other things. This is called REST API based integration. I will be talking about that one a little bit. So suppose here I am searching my, again, FRBR. Now you see, this time the result will be coming from Lens. So the same lens.org what I have shown you. So it is now popping up inside my e-learning system, giving all the result, telling me what are the open access have for me. So this way we can integrate any number of services. These are Union Catalog work in the same fashion. So I'm now going to show you for that, let me start my solar engine. So here you see, I integrated Intel library system. Intel library system is attached with only library open. So everything we actually integrated here. Let me start another server. So two of the associated systems are running so that I show you some of the things in live demo mode. It took me a little bit of time. Okay, so what I was talking about is basically related to how can we integrate our local library system as a proof of concept of managed learning environment. As I said, ML is nothing but integration of different kind of sub-components alongside your e-learning system. So suppose you are having a different in the Vishwavarathi, a different system. I hope you can see it properly, all of you. So here you see in the right hand side, I have integrated the entire Koha OPAC. So here people can select right from here that what are the things available. Now suppose I am selecting author, I am selecting Gandhi. So right from here, I want to search documents from my library catalog which are authored by. Now, as I said, that in a traditional learning environment, libraries and classroom are two separate systems. Now, integrating with each other through an interoperability standards called LTI, Learning Tools Interoperability. So now my module, you see, I am not leaving my system. Now my module is trying to contact my local library. And in my local library, you see, it retrieve all the books I am having in my library written by Mahatma Gandhi. Now, interesting thing is that this one, the story of my experiment with truth, you all know the famous. So if my students want to learn that, let me increase the size of this window slightly. You see what miracle we can do in e-learning. So right from here, my student can, if it is a copyright, we have all the legal rights to integrate that book inside our library. Today, that book, so it is now coming, it already can snatch a sense that this particular book is available in open access and from where it is available automatically. And it found that it is available from Gandhi Heritage Portal. And my student can read this book. So you see here, I am inside e-learning system. Inside the e-learning system, pop my OPAC, and inside my OPAC I can pop up the whole book, and just like a book in available in a Kindle and you are reading, and it is coming from the most source, the Gandhi Heritage Portal, running by the Sabarmati Ashram. So here you can see also the handwritten, some of the handwriting of Mahatma Gandhi, and it is coming from Gandhi Heritage Portal. My students or learner can read the book itself here. They can go to any silk pages. So I go to front cover, back cover, table of content, index page, and so on. I can print a particular page. So there it is. I can bookmark a particular page. I can go for the full text channel. I can zoom it on, or I can. So this kind of facilities are there, and you can write here, you can read the entire document. So this is one of the advantage you have, one of the informatics attitude we have adopted inside the e-learning system for different kind of reading materials. And right from here, they don't have to come to the library even, they can go for different kind of things. All 100 volumes of works of Gandhi, works of Mahatma Gandhi. So all 100 volumes will be available in future in Gandhi Heritage Portal. So in this way, lot many your textbook, your reading books nowadays are available. See, another thing we are trying, that if I can provide the text itself inside the e-learning system, can I also provide the analytical part of it? So we are trying to adapt a text analysis service inside there. So this is the my experiment with truth. Now if I go for the text analysis, at the same time, in the same interface, same web interface of the e-learning, tell you that what are topos term used by Mahatma Gandhi in this particular document. I can always increase the context. In the context of 300, almost 275. So these are the top terms used by M.K. Gandhi, a particular document. Now I can give my learner a scope to go for the different kind of other information visualization related to the purpose of the text of my experiment with you. Say for example, I'm showing you one of the bubble. So it can create bubbles related to terms actually appeared in this particular document. program identified 13,219 terms which are statistically significant, utilized more than once by Gandhiji and appeared. So at the same time, that means I said that e-learning or any kind of learning based on the scholarly material. We need to provide insight the e-learning, and additionally we can create lot many analysis kind of services which can give them a scope. So now you see another visualization tools, one of my most favorite, that is called textual art. So it can kind of system on the basis of movement of or the phrases appeared in different. Most interesting things we are trying, let me show you, as you are quite matured an audience I am having today, say how it can also relate different kind of geographical components. Say my experiments to think what me travel experiences of Gandhiji from Sabarmati Ashram to Gujarat to Delhi to London to South Africa. So my system can read and tell me that what are the different places Gandhiji moved. And it's really very challenging. We are trying it rapidly. Now you see here, it will appear as a global, it will first create a global map. And here you see this long short button. You can see here the centers it is running. It is moving from Porbandar to Rajkot. So a small graph is there. Now the moment it will say something, larger, travel history written in the book. So now it is moving all Rajkot to Bombay, Rajkot to Bombay. Now you see the long gap, the Rajkot to North America, again coming back. So it can read the whole book itself and identify what are the sentences and phrases, includes the name of the geographical place name, and it create a real-time linking between those places. Now suppose you want to know from South Africa where Gandhiji actually moved. So here, if you click the place your mouse cursor here, it can say Gandhiji written that from Pretoria, which of the places he actually moved around. So this kind of experiences are going on. Now, as you all are from, let me show you something we are doing with Gitovita. So I'm searching Gitovita. Hopefully it is available. Now this is also we can do learning based. Now here you see in Gita also I can read the full text of the document, and in most of cases, surprisingly, most of the Indian first editions of Indian volumes are coming from another source, open access source of books, that is called Open Archive or openlibrary.org. So I can read this book just like previously I did with Gandhi Heritage Portal. So the authenticated version with the stamp of Vishwabharati, it's available there. But that is not the great thing. The great thing is that the text analysis part in Bengali. So here you see in the Vitar, I can show you that what are the top terms utilized by Rabindranath Tagore. So these are the context of 30 terms. So this is a most of the terms appear, Toma, Na, Amar, etc. Then I go for the how terms are related to each other. Now, if I click the links button here, so it can tell me that how the context, I can always increase the context. So in this, you see many of the new things we can do with this thing. And let me show you another concept, mandala we are tying. Mandala can create in real time different kind of related with different parts of Gitovitan, different porjais of Gitovitan. So these are the terms, and these are related to different foci. So I can always search a particular term, add a particular term, and suppose I want to say how Tomar is actually appeared in different works of this thing. So Tomar now will be the key term, telling that which of the these documents or foci this particular term came. So apart from giving the full text of the document itself, you are giving lot. You can give lot many analytical system related with this log out next things. 2 minutes I will take. So next thing is that to see. Again, we can use different kind of authentication-based system through which my e-learning system available to my learner. Here you see, students can log on using Google ID, or they can utilize my local ID. So they don't have to create Moodle ID. So how it is happening? We are using here approach which is called auth2. That is basically REST API based authentication system. If your learner is having a Google ID, say for example I want to utilize my Google ID, this is for SSO, single sign-on. If I click my Google ID, it will be asking me that which of my ID I want to use to enter this system. If I click this one, so I will be entering this thing, and my Moodle administrator will be getting notification that what of the ID I am utilizing, and if this course is available for go for it. So similarly, of my local cohort is my library system here. I don't have to create another new identity in by utilizing that library's credential. I can enter inside the Moodle. So another great integration is happening between different systems, because you. So you will be running in more than 5-6 related systems. So how many times your users will be having their different passwords and different login? It's the need of time where people can utilize their Google keyword, their Microsoft credential, their local Koha system or library the keyword to enter inside the Moodle. So now I can use my Moodle keywords inside my local Koha, so that I can enter with all credentials related with Moodle. Similarly, with all Koha credentials, I can enter inside Moodle. So that's all from my side, and it's a lot to assist. I hope you are not bored enough.
No, sir, not at all.
Actually, we wish that we could have continued this, but it's really very tough to talk for long, 2 hours. But as always, it's really a pleasure to hear you, and I try to follow you all the time wherever you do lecture. I try to attend it. I hope most of the participants also is having the same kind of experience that on the chat box. What I find is most of the people are really very very happy about your lecture. So I have 2 questions received from the chat box. So may I go ahead with the questions, sir?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
Okay. So I got one question from. Dr. Tapas Mistry, I hope he is from Sardwan University. So this is one common question normally we find in all the e-learning kind of discussions, that due to lack of these technological problems, that what is the prospect of e-learning, that's number one. And number two, will this be concentrated to the particular class of people and thus creating another form of literacy? Illiteracy is the economically weaker. What is the blueprint of the government, if you have any idea?
Yeah, it's okay. This question, definitely all the people who are dealing with e-learning facing right from the beginning when we started this movement way back in 2007. So the thing is that let me ask you a counter question. So if I ask you that still in the higher education system, our enrollment, gross enrollment ratio is only 26.3. So we never included 100% of our students or learners inside our higher education. Have we stopped higher education? Do you think 100% of the students are inside the school education system? Have we stopped school education? So initially, you may be targeting only 30 to 40% of the students. So don't worry about that. Take the point of view of an engineer. Start what you are having on your table. So on our table, we have open source software, e-learning software, like very advanced system like Moodle, lot many open contents that we can integrate, that we can start. Initially, you are targeting only 40% of the students. But you see, in future, universities and colleges will be receiving equipment grants in place the building grants. So that equipment grants we can spend to procure low cost devices, communicating devices for our students. And another revolution is happening in the hardware level. You know, there is a recent model of the Raspberry Pi, which is called QT Pi. QT Pi is basically preloaded with all kind of e-learning facilities and connecting options. So that kind of computer will be available in the market at the cost of 6 to 7,000. So in future, what will be happening? That distributed free of cost to the BPL cardholder students because of the equipment grants the universities and colleges will be receiving future. Because in future, we don't need building grant, we need equipment grant, and BPL cardholder can give it free of cost. Another bottleneck of the communication process is the network. So network bandwidth is very poor in remote villages. Let me share you the plan of the Government of India as part of the NME ICT committee, that we in the university level, if you ask me, that we are all enjoying a very good 2 Gbps connectivity because of the NKN connectivity system. Now government is planning to expand that NKN connectivity up to the college level. Now from college level, in the next 6 months, it will be expanded to the every GP in the public library system. E-learning system cannot operate in isolation. It requires partnership. So public libraries can be a very good point of presence in future, because every GP in India, every Gram Panchayat of India includes at least one or two public libraries. So from college, it will go to the public libraries. Each public library will be equipped with a solid AV room, audiovisual room, when it will be acting as the cluster for all schools available in that particular GP, and that can serve. So things cannot happen in one fine morning. It takes time, because the entire educational system took almost 400 years to come to this particular place. So e-learning will take time. So my suggestion is that let us take an engineer's approach and start what you are having. Finally, we will be, this will actually covering all sections of the society. And you just see the advantages it is getting. A remote village students, if he or she is connected, getting the lecture series on C language or database management system from an IIT teacher. And that you don't think an advantage. So many advantages are associated with the e-learning. There are many bottlenecks, as I said, but slowly this will be diminishing. So that's my sharp point of view.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. Actually, we also have the same question, and I also tried to answer like this, that could not bring all the kids in the physical classroom as well. And so, Raspberry Pi yesterday, day before yesterday in our session, that we just showed it physically, that focus with the how beautifully it used. And in our last workshop, we had shown the Raspberry Pi in operation.
Very good.
Yeah, thank you. You were also there in 2019. Thank you very much.
That center, na?
Yeah, AKD center. Yeah.
Okay.
I have one question from my side. As you spoke about the four quadrant approach, and in quadrant three, you showed that wavelengths we have to provide. Can we provide the books references?
The entire book?
No, reference. in quantum.
Sorry if you misunderstood me. But what I said, that most of the resources, that resource may be a book, maybe an article, maybe a technical report, anything under the sun it can be. But you must check whether it is available over the web and available as open access object. Every time you have to provide only web references, that I have not actually meant. I meant that it can be anything, but please check whether it is accessible over the web and available as open.
Okay, thank you very much. I got it right now. One more thing I would like to point out is that sometimes it is very difficult to restrict the video with 25 minutes, because I made some videos at home and the topics are so difficult to restrict within 5 minutes. So I would come at least 52
yes.
minutes in my yes. one of my 52 minutes. Now,
okay.
if we have to bring, or if we have to keep such a view, I think that should not be over-specified, or that should be acceptable, right?
Yeah. So here my suggestion is that in many of the cases when you are tackling some kind of difficult concept, it may go up to 30 minutes. So my suggestion is that in that particular case, you use a video editor and divide your video into two parts, part one and part two. And just arrange your lecture in such a way that you can have part one within 25-27 minutes and part two another 25-7 minutes. So what people are suggesting like that, because of this, nowadays one particular interesting study came that every 12 minutes a child concentration is breaking. One particular psychological test report came recently. Interesting finding also that every 12 minutes there is a TV commercial break. So it basically creates the mentality of a student to concentrate only 12 minutes. So shorter is the length of your video, higher will be the impact. So please remember this rule. And in that case, if you do not cover a particular topic within 30 minutes, try to divide it to part one, part two, part three. So in that way, users will enjoy, or learner will enjoy most.
Okay, thank you very much, sir, for your kind advice. One more point I have, that is, though we have installed a Moodle in our own server, cloud server, but like Genomeo, it's really 500 users is a really great advantage. But does it allow to plug in like VPN, or it has to be installed?
Two limitations were there. One is the advertisement pop-up. Second is the some of the plugins they have included, no further plugin you can install.
Okay, so do you any idea what are the plugins available? I mean, if you can remember. Yes.
Related to what?
Related to Moodle.
Oh, what are the plugins available inside Genomeo?
Yeah.
Most of the basic plugins related to your teaching learning evaluation, all available. What I badly missed from my blue button.
That's very important.
Big blue button is not there. But what I am doing, I took an alternative process. I separately started one big blue button account. Create one particular classroom, got the link key and the link URL, and inside my Genomeo I paste that, and I request my students to click that link to join. So in this way you can get over.
If somebody wishes to use Genomeo, they can do like that. Yeah, that's a good alternative. Yeah, and I can just say one more thing, because I'm using Moodle for a couple of years. I mean, just learning from you, I just started after I heard you 2 years back. So I definitely owe you on this. Like glossary part, I never used, but definitely I would try it further, and that really helps. And then and today what we learned, like Vimeo, YouTube and Vimeo, right? So Vimeo channel, I think you are suggesting it than YouTube, right?
YouTube. Because point is that because in YouTube, after the end of the YouTube video, what will come next as a suggested video, you simply don't know. So that kind of problem is not there in Bhavya.
Mm-hmm. So in that case, actually, I right now, I put all the things in my Google Drive and link it over there. But I think it's a good thing what we learned today. I can
Google Drive is not a video streaming server. There you are using, utilizing Firefox own video streaming. But yeah. Video streaming champion is YouTube. Next comes Vimeo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and another thing what we need to practice, I was talking to mind of when while your presentation was going on, that OPEC charts and this, you told me that we are going to discuss this, like this referencing tool, and you just go and get the book when you are reading the topic. And that's a real, real plus today, what I had specially, because I never used this. But probably I need to ask you more on other occasions to learn this part. But I'm sure all of our participants has got the great sense of e-learning and why do we need that. And I hope today's session is a great one. And still, if you have any question, the participants, they can ask, because we have 10 minutes more. But if you have any, you can go ahead.
Dr. Ghosh, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can. Please go ahead.
I am Devra Chakravarti once again. I am just trying to... thank you. Trying to clear my doubt after the wonderful presentation by Professor Mukhopadhyay. It's indeed an excellent presentation. Sir, I would like to ask that in our college educational system, because of this pandemic, we have already introduced online teaching learning method. And being a coordinator of Shyam, I have also introduced our students, particularly I am with girls college that is affiliated to your university, that is Bahrampur Girls College. I have already introduced our girls with the UGC Shyam and other Vidyamitra and other portal that are available with. Now there is a specific demand from our student, particularly they are asking for materials. In that case, we are uploading the materials to our college website for their easy accessibility. But we find that in my case, you can even search it through our website, that some of the materials have been downloaded around 600 to 700 times. And when I asked my computer operator, the system operator, that I have a query that one person is downloading for 10 times, she told me, no, sir, it is apparently downloaded from 700 systems. That is why it is showing that 700. My college administration told me, Devraj, immediately stop it, because the materials are widely distributing to the other. But we have a very typical mindset that is our material and it should be restricted to ourselves. In this web world, we are talking about the globalization of education. This web world, to what extent this sort of mentality would provide us a platform to afford the control over the material. Sir, what is your observation being a professor of life design?
You see, I am a strong believer of open access system. If we share, we are halfway there. Now you see, all things we have learned, all things we we are implementing, you are getting Vidyamitra and many other resources, the full text e-sources as I showed you, we are getting it. When we will be developing something, we will be restricting it, that goes against the principle. So my suggestion is that do not care for this kind of views, because the future is open and digital. And everybody will understand in coming future also. So that is that the one particular point of piece of advice. It's not advice, it's a suggestion to you are my colleague, that you better always attach the licensing system system at the end of your text or at end of your presentation or end of your video. So that licensing system we need to know nowadays, that is called Creative Commons licensing. So there are six variants of Creative Commons licensing. You read that, it's a very simple, you know, paragraph and points of freedom given there. You now select that what kind of freedom you want to give it to others. Then you just give a Creative Commons licensing marks there. So that the copyleft movement, you are leaving the copy for the utilization of others as you have utilized copies given by others. So that's a simple.
Thank you sir.
Yeah, that's a great attitude we should have, I think, and it's really nice to hear you again, sir. I know you are speaking, I mean, every day or every alternate day, and we are fortunate enough that even after the disruption of our normal schedule, you could arrange your day for us, and we are really grateful to you. And we hope that we will get your help in future as well as required. One more question I have is that from last lots of participants asking for the PPT.
Yeah. I will.
If you share it with me or Nimaida, that will be great. We can share it with our participants, and that's how we can follow that. Okay. So I think today.
And there was one point I would like to mention against the question of Devraj Babu, that in this particular slide you see the end slide of mine and what licensing system I have given there. So you can follow that pattern in your PPT or your.
Sure, sir. Many thanks.
Okay, so I think thank you very much, sir. We don't have any other, adjective to hats you off. You are always kind to us. And today, I think we should close our session, and I will be sharing the feedback form, maybe a couple of hours, and you please give us the feedback so that we can prepare for the next event. And right now we are closing our session, and thank you very much.
Okay, bye.
Yeah, one small announcement I can make, and that is tomorrow there is a session at 10:30, and day after tomorrow also there is another session, because yesterday we did not have any. So tomorrow 10:30, day after tomorrow also 10:30, I will be sending you the emails, so I think you can follow that. And thank you very much, have a good day.